if you think it's selfish of me to say no for a photo or for your time or to for a hug. That's not normal. That's weird. It's weird.
Oh no, won't somebody please feel bad for the celebrities and the multimillionaires? Babe, Chappell Roan, you gotta be kidding me. Come on now. A pop star wants us to feel so bad and so terrible for the celebrities among us. Republican J.D. Vance makes a massive error on live TV, and a TikToker has an insane threat for MAGA supporters. All this and so much more is coming up on today's episode of the Brad vs. Everyone podcast, my daily show, where I take on the craziest ideas from across the internet and across our politics, all from a center-right independent perspective. If you're new here, please do consider subscribing and sticking around. And regardless, do hit that like button and do comment with your thoughts as we go along. I do take the time to read the comments and I pick a few to respond to in every episode. Now, before we get into our main topics for today, I do want to take a second and issue a quick correction. You guys may remember last week, I discussed a truck at the DNC that was offering free abortions and free vasectomies. That story was real, but I presented it in a way that wasn't quite accurate because it was not, as I suggested, an official DNC program or officially sponsored by or partnered with the Democratic National Convention. It was done independently by Planned Parenthood, and I did want to clarify that, and I apologize for misleading you in that way. I always try to be 100% factual, even though I'm giving you my opinion, so I want to apologize for that mistake. Now, I will say, to me, it doesn't change a ton, because Democrats, even if they didn't officially sponsor this, they do support Planned Parenthood, and most of them would have no problem with this. They would support this. So in the same way, I think people would draw conclusions about the GOP if the NRA held an event outside of the RNC giving away AR-15s, I think people would draw a conclusion about the Democrats based on their friendliness and support for Planned Parenthood and the way that Planned Parenthood was doing this, clearly as a publicity stunt, at least somewhat tied to the convention. I don't think it's totally unfair, like the whole story is a nothing burger, but I do apologize for presenting it in an inaccurate way. Oh, and I hope you guys didn't miss me too much while I was gone last week in Colorado. I was actually there to accept a very prestigious and very exciting fellowship opportunity, and I actually gave a little speech, which I will share with you guys in a couple days when I receive the video. Anyway, without further ado, let's talk about Chappell Roan. And if you haven't heard of her, you're certainly not alone. She's not a household name, at least not yet. But she's this independent kind of punk pop artist who sprang onto the scene and absolutely exploded. She's been doing this for many years, creating music, but for whatever reason, she went super viral and became super popular like 4 to 6 months ago. First with this really great song called, oh gosh, how am I possibly forgetting this? Call Me Baby, which a lot of people have loved. I really loved Sabrina Carpenter's cover of it. And then other songs like Pink Pony Club. Oh my God, that one has been stuck in my head. It's all over TikTok. And I'll be walking with my boyfriend and I'll go out of nowhere, Pink Pony Club, I'm gonna keep on dancing at the Pink Pony Club. Let me know, guys. Do I have a career in singing and dancing if this whole political commentary YouTube thing doesn't work out? My mom thinks I'm great. Surely you're not suggesting she's wrong. That would be very rude. Anyway, more seriously, Chappell Roan has become this huge sensation. And she's now like, she just did a music festival and the crowds were insane. I know somebody who was there. They said that crowds for her were unlike every other artist. She's really blowing up. She's becoming a sensation. But unfortunately, she doesn't appear to be handling the spotlight very well. She recently went viral because she rejected a fan who asked to take a photo with her in public. And then when she was getting backlash for it online, she posted some videos essentially saying like she really has no interest in talking to fans in public and they have no right to ask for photos and she doesn't have to do that and people need to leave her alone and not expect anything of her. So let's take a listen to her first video because I have some thoughts and we'll get into it. But first, let's hear it straight from the horse's mouth. Here's Chappell Roan, part one.
I need you to answer questions. Just answer my questions for a second. If you saw a random woman on the street, would you yell at her from the car window? Would you harass her in public? Would you go up to a random lady and say, can I get a photo with you? And she's like, no, what the fuck? And then you get mad at this random lady? Would you be offended if she says no to your time because she has her own time? Would you stalk her family? Would you follow her around? Would you try to dissect her life and bully her online? This is a lady you don't know. And she doesn't know you at all. Would you assume that she's a good person? Assume she's a bad person? Would you assume everything you read about her online is true? I'm a random bitch. You're a random bitch. Just think about that for a second, okay?
Okay, sorry, y'all. Reggie was harassing me to give him attention, so maybe if I hold him, he'll be quiet and I can record this freaking podcast for you. But anyway, Chappell, babe, you are not a random bitch. You are a massive pop star, you are a sensation, and very soon to be at least, a multi-multi-millionaire. And you owe all of that to your fans, who, guess what? If they see you on the street and they want to stop you and ask you for a photo, you should do it. It's the least you can do, because you owe all your success to them, and it's really not that much to ask. It's giving ungrateful, it's giving out of touch. I mean, look, people literally work 12, 14-hour shifts in factories every day in this country, and you're out here in public complaining because people want a photo, because people want a signature or, you know, an autograph or whatever. Give me a break. I also have to say, I have a real issue with conflating two different things in this video, because obviously she doesn't deserve to be stalked or have her family harassed, and nobody should be spreading fake news about her. So, like, even in this video, she identifies some very valid complaints and things that shouldn't happen to anyone, including a celebrity, that I can have sympathy with her for those things. But then she's conflating it with people just wanting autographs or people driving by and yelling Pink Pony Club at her from their cars. It's like, girl, that is not the move. This did not go for her how she thought it would, hence why she actually had to turn comments off on her own video, even though this was on TikTok, which loves her. It's an adoring audience, and it's a super woke audience that's usually extraordinarily deferential to claims of victimhood or oppression or sad stories. Even they weren't buying this pity party, so I found that pretty interesting. There is more. She did explain further in a second part of the video. Let's take a look at that now.
I don't care that abuse and harassment, stalking, whatever, is a normal thing to do to people who are famous or a little famous, whatever. I don't care that it's normal. I don't care that this crazy type of behavior comes along with the job, the career field I've chosen. That does not make it okay. That doesn't make it normal. It doesn't mean I want it. It doesn't mean that I like it. I don't want whatever the fuck you think you're supposed to be entitled to whenever you see a celebrity. I don't give a fuck if you think it's selfish of me to say no for a photo or for your time or for a hug. That's not normal. That's weird. It's weird how people think that you know a person just because you see them online or you listen to the art they make. That's weird. I'm allowed to say no to creepy behavior, okay?
Oh boy. So that follow-up video really didn't help Miss Chappell's cause with the audience, and she again had to turn comments off because, yikes, you made things worse for yourself, babe. Again, she did this really unfortunate thing of lumping in stalking and unacceptable behavior that, yes, absolutely, even celebrities should not have to deal with, although it is part of the territory, and you do know that going into the field, but still it's wrong. Like, nobody should be harassed or intimidated and in those truly scary ways. I've heard horror stories from people far less famous than Chappell Roan. And then she's conflating that with creepy behavior, like asking for a photo. Yes, it's not normal because normal people don't get asked for photos very often, but guess what else is not normal? Being a massive celebrity, playing sold-out concert halls, getting millions of dollars on huge record deals. Those things aren't normal either, babe. And for you to want to enjoy all the perks of your abnormality, but not even the most minor downsides that mean something for fans. I mean, look, I'm not a celebrity. I'm not even a particularly big or notable influencer or YouTuber, but I have had people who recognize me from TV hits or from social media stop me in the airport or in public and say, hey, are you Brad Polumbo? Blah, 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 blah. And I'm an antisocial person. I'm like very much an introvert. I like to stay at home with Reggie and my boyfriend and not really socialize, but I always put on a smile. I always make small talk, even though I really can't stand small talk. And I do it because we owe everything to you guys. We owe everything to the people who watch our content, who listen to our content, who see our stuff. The least we can do is take a picture. Then you should do it with a smile. It's so out of touch. I cannot stand this entitlement of, oh, I deserve all the trappings of fame and luxury, but none of the downsides. I don't owe you, the fans, the time of day. It's really astounding. And then I just, again, to lump it all in with actual creepy behavior is really, Reggie, be good, is really disingenuous and disappointing. This whole thing is just so incredibly disappointing from Chappell Roan. Just when I think that the celebrity class couldn't get more out of touch, they always find a way. They always, always find a way. Now, you guys let me know what you think of Chappell's plea and her attitude here in the comments below. And do hit that like button as we go along. Up next, we're going to talk about Republican VP nominee J.D. Vance, who just made a huge mistake during a TV interview. You guys know I'm not the biggest J.D. Vance fan, but I will give anybody credit when they say something that I think is right, and I will give anybody criticism when I say something that I think is wrong or off base. And that's the category that J.D. Vance's recent commentary during an interview with Meet the Press falls into when he discussed tariffs and trade policy under the Trump administration and flunked an Econ 101 test. Let's take a look at that clip.
Sure. Trump's record during his first term, he did impose rounds of tariffs, and it cost Americans nearly $80 billion in new taxes. Do you acknowledge that imposing more tariffs will ultimately cost consumers?
Well, what it really does is it penalizes importers from bringing goods outside the country into the country. And I think that's just a necessary thing. We know that China and a number of other countries are using effectively slave labor to undercut the wages of American workers. Donald Trump thinks that has to stop. And again, what Kamala Harris is saying, Kristen, is that if you do this, you're somehow going to cause skyrocketing inflation. In reality, Donald Trump already did it. He brought a lot of jobs back, and it didn't cause inflation.
But it caused consumers to pay more. They paid more in taxes, $80 billion worth. Do you acknowledge that consumers ultimately will pay more if there are more tariffs imposed?
So economists,
you just acknowledge that?
No, I don't, Kristen, because I think economists really disagree about the effects of tariffs because there can be a dynamic effect, right? So what some economists will say is what you just said, that it will actually raise costs for consumers. But what other people say, and I think the record supports what this other view, is that it causes this dynamic effect where more jobs come into the country. Anything that you lose on the tariff from the perspective of the consumer, you gain in higher wages, so you're ultimately much better off. You have more take-home pay, you have better jobs.
So there's a lot to unpack here, because I honestly think that J.D. Vance is just totally wrong on this. First and foremost, he brings up China, but the Trump administration did not just put tariffs on China. They put tariffs on all sorts of goods from all sorts of countries, including our allies like Canada and Mexico, including the EU on many products. So China, we can debate China. It is a unique situation. I still think a lot of the tariffs are counterproductive, but invoking China doesn't actually defend your trade policy more broadly because your tariffs have been put on a lot more than just China. In the same way, you cannot deny the objective factual reality that consumers get hit hard by tariffs. They pay the price. They did under the Trump administration. They have continued to do so under the Biden-Harris administration, which has left many of those tariffs in place. And if Trump and Vance got their agenda that they're running on, which includes, for example, a 10% flat tariff, an import tax on all goods coming into the country, if they got that agenda, that would cost consumers tremendously as well. There's just no denying it. You can argue it's worth it and say that it helps in other ways, and I disagree, but we can have that argument, but you cannot deny the costs involved here. According to the Nonpartisan Tax Foundation, almost $80 billion in costs was imposed on consumers through the Trump administration's tariffs when he was president. And if he gets his 10% tax that he wants across the board, that would cost the average estimated annual household something between $1,700 and $2,300 and $50 annually. So thousands of dollars in additional expenses for hardworking American families who really can't afford that right now would be the result of this additional tariff plan. Now, maybe you could use the revenue to cut other taxes and we can have that discussion, but there is no denying the trade-offs, the downsides of increased consumer costs. Because if they don't increase consumer costs, here's the thing, how do they even work at their stated goal? The stated goal from Trump and Vance and people who support tariffs, and I'm a free trader, but people who do, is that they will protect U.S. industries. For example, if you put tariffs on steel incoming into the country, imported steel, U.S. steel manufacturers will do better. How? Because they'll be able to charge higher prices to meet the increase in the tariff or just a little bit undercut it so that the other people are more expensive and they can charge more while still being less expensive than the foreign competition. That's the whole point, is that it helps them by raising prices. So you cannot advocate for these policies while also gaslighting us and claiming they don't raise prices. They do. Now, J.D. Vance, what he does sort of before denying this is say, well, it's worth it because it helps protect jobs. And I think that's wrong, but we can at least have a constructive debate on that subject. For example, the Trump administration's steel tariffs very famously did protect some jobs in steel manufacturing, but many, many, many times more jobs were lost in other fields that use steel as an input, that and their costs went up and they had to cut jobs and lower production. So again, counterproductive. But we can at least have that debate, but don't deny that there are costs involved. That's really dumb, really dishonest, not good stuff. J.D. Vance is also totally, totally wrong to suggest that economists disagree about how tariffs work. It's actually one of the only areas where economists nearly universally, there's almost a universal consensus that tariffs are not good for consumers and are not effective at increasing the overall welfare of our economy. So to claim otherwise, yeah, no, the facts are not facting for you there, my friend. Here's a one survey that was pointed out by the economist Scott Linsacombe, who I'm a big fan of, on Twitter. Narrator, they do not disagree. And then he shows a poll over time from 1990 to 2000 to 2011 to 2021 of economists ask, and they're asked this question, do tariffs and import quotas usually reduce general economic welfare? 95% in all four surveys all said, yes, the tariffs don't work. They decrease overall economic welfare, which is the opposite of what J.D. Vance and those types suggest they would do. So, I mean, I guess there's a few economists out there, but to suggest there's serious disagreement on this subject just simply isn't true. Economists left, right, and center almost universally think tariffs and trade policies are a bad idea, and that should tell you something, because they agree on very, very little. But the data really are that strong on trade tariffs and trade wars more broadly being a bad idea that you do have a near consensus. So when J.D. Vance goes on TV and say economists disagree, not really, not really, J.D. You guys let me know what you think of J.D. Vance's arguments in the comments below. Do you agree with him or do you agree with me? Either way, I do want to hear from you guys. So do let me know and do hit that like button while you're at it. And now it's time for Brad versus TikTok, my daily segment where I take on the craziest ideas from the clock app. Today, we're going to watch a truly insane TikTok where one TikToker issues a bizarre and honestly just strange warning to MAGA supporters about what people like her, I guess, will do if we vote the wrong way in November, which I think we all know what that means. So let's take a listen to this really, really creepy and weird video.
So I had to jump on here to share with you all the real gay agenda, just so everybody's informed. If you all get in this voting booth in November acting like you don't have any sense and we lose our right to love who we want to love, we're taking your man.
Oh?
We're taking your woman. Imagine coming home to your family house and I'm in your dad's recliner. I've smashed your mom. She's baking me cookies. I'm just petty enough to do it. Or your dad. Because I'm at the age where I can have both you, them, and your younger sister, Ashley, that just turned 26. All of them can get it. Huh? Imagine your wife, who don't want to be with you anyway, but society says she has, runs off with a gay man to live her best life in a mansion with poodles. No worries. Huh? Trans woman, trans man, taking your whole family unit apart because you want to play. I just want to tell you all, that is the real agenda for the Alphabet Gang. Keep playing with us. You need to get in that booth and vote like you have some sense, okay? Our rights depend on it, and I'm not playing with you. You look up, and I got Barbara upside down. Now you mad. Uh-uh. Keep that same energy. If I can't do what I want to do, I'm going to do everything else, okay?
You know, guys, having been on TikTok for several years now, having reacted to so many of these videos, it is kind of rare that they still surprise me, but this one had me shook. I was shooketh, honestly. Like, excuse me, ma'am, sir, whatever. Like, what? You're going to threaten people with seducing their wife, husband, and or sister? Did I hear this correctly? I mean, there's so many weird things about this video. It's just not a normal response to have to political disagreements, to threaten to break up someone's family unit because you don't like the way they vote. That is incredibly unhinged behavior and leaves really no room for respecting our differences or disagreement or agreeing to disagree or anything like that. And it's all based on this false premise that you hear from the LGBT crowd, the LGBT activist crowd, not the normal sane gays and lesbians like me, of course, but the activist crowd. You hear this all the time. Our rights are on the line. And for as far as gays and lesbians and bisexuals are concerned, that really isn't true. Trump supports gay marriage, so even if he were to win, that's really not in danger. It's enshrined into federal law, even if the Supreme Court were to overturn it, which I don't think they're going to do. Even if they did, it's still enshrined into federal law. It's like gay rights are not under attack or up for debate in a super meaningful way at the federal level at all, really. That's pure scaremongering. Now, trans is a different question. And I think in some ways, what they consider to be trans rights are under debate or up for scrutiny or being legislated. And the different nuances of that get complicated because some of those ways, I think, are reasonable restrictions. For example, preserving sex-based women's sports and saying people born biologically male can't compete. Some of those things, like some state laws that would block adults from getting gender transitions, I do think are genuinely attacks on the rights and dignity of transgender people that I don't support. But most of that action is happening at the state level, first of all. And how far Trump would really be able to go on any of that at the federal level is pretty open question. I mean, unless he had full control of all the branches of government, which is incredibly unlikely, I'm not sure he could change all that much beyond the federal agency level in terms of he would need actual legislation to make sweeping changes. And unless he gets a 60 vote majority in the Senate, that's not going to happen. So on that one, I don't think it's as much fear mongering to say our rights are up for debate or our rights are on the ballot. Like, that's somewhat true, but I don't think it's as dire as they make it out to be. And regardless, it certainly doesn't justify trying to break up other people's families or weaponized sexualization. Like, it's also like LGBT people need to stop posting online things that seem perfectly calibrated to essentially confirm the biases that people have against us. Like, LGBTs coming for your family, coming for your kids. Not really. Not most of us. Like, I'm certainly not. Gays like me all over this country are not doing that in any way, shape, or form. But then you have some LGBT activists taking a TikTok and being like, yeah, I'm coming for your family. I'm coming for your wife and your dad and maybe your daughter. Like, you're just giving genuinely anti-LGBT conservatives and right-wingers ammunition to feed their stereotypes and their prejudices and to continue to foment backlash. So great work, babe. You're doing amazing. Keep it up. So the other thing about this person is that there's a little bit of like arrogance to this, as if this person just thinks they must be so hot that like people can't resist them. Like, I could have your dad. I could have your wife. I could have your sister. I really don't think you could. I don't think you could steal my boyfriend because I don't think he would be into you. And I actually don't think anyone could steal him because we actually have a strong and special relationship. And I like, unless you really can't steal someone's man or someone's wife or anything like that. Like, if they're not loyal to begin with, is the only way they can be stolen. A loyal person in a healthy, strong relationship can't be enticed away, no matter how hot you think you are. And so to whatever extent this was meant seriously, which I guess I question, it may have also just been a form of rage bait, engagement bait. And here I go, feeding that. I do acknowledge my part in this in some small way. To whatever extent this was meant at all seriously, it doesn't even make sense. Like, it really doesn't. I don't think there's going to be an epidemic of people's wives and husbands running away with transgender people who seduce them. Also, how are you even going to know who votes for who? That's private. That's not like publicly listed information. The whole video is just totally nonsensical. And yes, to use a word Democrats have been using a lot lately, It's weird. You guys let me know what you think of this crazy clip in the comments below, and do remember to hit that like button. And now, I'll wrap up the show by reading a couple of your comments from last week. Up first, one person says, I love that you call out all the BS. Keep up the good work to bring this country back. Yeah, I will do my best. I know, honestly, just criticizing the left would be the biggest path to just growing my channel and growing my audience, but I would find that boring and not really intellectually honest. So I'll continue to push in both directions, and you guys don't always have to agree with me, but I do appreciate you hearing me out and sticking with me. I really do. Another person writes, I genuinely love sarcastic Brad. He's so cute. That's good, because I try to be sassy without sometimes, you know, being unserious, but I also don't want to take myself too seriously, right? Because I'm not all that. I'm not some scholar and expert. I'm just a person with an education in economics and politics and some years of experience covering it that knows a thing or two and has some strong opinions, but I'm not, you know, the bee's knees, all that. So I don't want to take myself too seriously. So I'm not above a little sass. Another person says, Brad, you've made it. Here in Australia, there's a famous radio station, Triple J, and one of the announcers on the lunchtime show yesterday said, put the crack pipe down. You've had enough. Freaking priceless. You know, I'd like to take credit for that, but I think there's probably a good chance that that's just a coincidence and that they said that from somewhere else. However, you know, millions of people do see my content on YouTube and my content on Instagram in particular from all over the world. So could be that someone in that team is a viewer of my content. And if so, good for you. You've got good taste, I have to say. Another person says, something that bothers me about political commentators on the left and right is that I see too many get pulled further and further to one side or the other. You've always got to be checking yourself no matter which side you're on, or you'll end up becoming exactly what you criticize. This is really true, and I think this is true because of a phenomenon that a lot of people call audience capture, but essentially the people who engage with content the most are the people who feel super strongly one way or the other. A lot of the people who are center left or center right or moderate don't really engage with political content that much. They are just going about their lives and they're not super political people. So the most active audiences, which will reward you the most with views and be the most lucrative in terms of paying for Patreons and sponsorships and all that, are not all of them, but a lot of them are nestled either on the far right or the far left. So the best way to get in with that super rewarding audience is to pander to the far right or the far left. I guess I just don't care that much about being popular. I mean, I want to be because I want my message to be heard, but if the price of becoming popular is compromising what I actually believe and what I mean, that's not worth it to me. So I'd rather be unpopular, to be honest. So I'll try to stay different from that, but you guys can keep me in check in the comments. Another person writes, and this is about Candace Owens attacking Javier Milei for having blue eyes. Distrusting and condemning someone based on physical features like this is so dangerous. Yeah, I agree. It's really dumb. You can't control your eye color. It doesn't make you more or less credible. I mean, other than gingers who have no soul and cannot be trusted.
It pisses me off! Ginger people do have souls, alright?
I joke. Of course, guys. I love my gingers if they're in my audience. Another person says, Kamala reminds me of the kid who promises extra recess and free Snickers bars as her platform for class president, but you left out part of that comment, but then can't actually deliver that. That's the thing. I mean, she's campaigning on all these solutions that it's like, babe, you're literally in power now. If you really had all the answers, couldn't you have done it over the last 3 years? You would think, right? Another person says, I'm learning that Brad is unfortunately not open to large-scale conspiracies. Bummer. I'm not 100% closed, but I'm deeply skeptical of large-scale conspiracies because the bigger and the larger the scale of a conspiracy, the more and more people it would require to stay silent and not leak or not tell anyone. So if you were going to have a crazy conspiracy theory that would span the globe, but that would mean at minimum thousands and thousands of people would have to be in on it, and not one of them is ever going to leak anything to a journalist or tell the world. I mean, they would all have a strong incentive to do so, and not one of them is. That's why I'm deeply skeptical of big scale conspiracies. I'm not saying they're never possible, but I'm pretty skeptical. It's like, show me the proof first. I'm not going to just believe you or entertain stuff for its own sake. Another person writes, honestly, the mental image of you singing men are trash to yourself as you're with your boyfriend is slightly hilarious, and I love it. I keep doing it. I keep being like, men are trash. And he looks at me and he's like, babe? And I'm like, sorry, I'll stop. All right, everybody, that is it. for this episode of the Brad versus Everyone podcast. Thank you all so much for tuning in. I love doing this show. I missed you all last week. Please do subscribe if you haven't yet. Do hit that like button before you go and do comment with your thoughts from today's episode. I do read the comments and I pick a few to respond to, so I will possibly read your comment. If you leave it with a super thanks, I will definitely read your comment unless it's like really inappropriate or something. So do all that and we'll talk again tomorrow.